What's up? Medite here. Let's talk about the anatomy of the oral cavity. Now, since this is my first video of the digestive system, I want to spend a quick minute giving you a little overview of the whole digestive system. And to do that, we will use this chocolate cheesecake to highlight all the structures it's going to go through within your digestive system. The reason why I chose the cheesecake is because it most probably starts you salivating because you probably want to eat it. That implies that the oral cavity is the first part of the digestive system. After the oral cavity is the pharynx. Then when you swallow the food, it's going to go through the esophagus and then all the way down to your stomach. After it's been processed by the hydrochloric acid in the stomach, it's then going to enter the small intestine, which consists of the duodenum, then the jejunum, and the ileum. And after the ileum, it's going to enter the large intestine, which consists of the cecum, and the colon, and the rectum. And by the time it gets to here, this is how the cheesecake is going to look like. And the fuller the rectum gets, the higher you feel the urge to poop. So those are all the structures of the digestive system. But we also have a system of accessory structures, which will help you digest the food we eat. Those include the teeth, tongue, and the salivary glands. And then in the abdominal cavity, there's the liver, gallbladder, and the pancreas. So our goal is to go through the detailed anatomy of all of these structures, one by one, and we will start with the oral cavity. So in this video, we're first going to talk about the main external structures of the mouth. Then we're going to go through the division of the oral cavity, basically how we divide the oral cavity. After that, we're going to talk about the structures associated with the borders of the oral vestibule, which include the anatomy of the lips, cheeks, and the teeth. And then in the next video, we'll focus on the other part of the oral cavity, which is the oral cavity proper. Cool. So here we see the external mouth. You probably didn't know this, but here's the upper lip and here's the lower lip. And they both meet at the lateral ends as the oral angle or the labial commissure. Above the lips, you're going to have two grooves on either side, as you see here, called the nasolabial sulcus. And then in the middle, there's going to be a depression called the philtrum. And then under the lips, there's going to be another sulcus called the mentolabial sulcus or the mentolabial fold. Now, remember the muscle that's located inside of your lips, the orbicularis oris muscle? This muscle is going to help you regulate the opening of the mouth, and that opening is called the oral fissure, or in Latin, Rima oris. And that, my friends, are going to be the opening of our digestive pathway. Now, we generally divide the oral cavity into two parts. There's the oral vestibule, here in green, and the oral cavity proper, here in blue. And the dividing line between these two parts are going to be the teeth and the gums. Alright, so again, in this video, we're mainly going to focus on the oral vestibule, and we're going to do that by going through the structures associated with the external and the internal borders. The external border of the oral vestibule are going to be the lips and the cheeks, and the internal borders of the oral vestibule are the teeth and gums. Awesome, so let's go through the anatomy of these, starting with the lips. Now, the most basic things you need to know about the anatomy of the lips is that the inner and the outer sides of the lips are covered by different types of epithelium. That's why that your lips kind of feel different on the inside and the outside. And there's usually a transitional zone between these two sides. Now, the upper lip is attached to the gums through the frenulum of the upper lip. And the lower lip is attached to the gums through the frenulum of the lower lip. And within the mucosa of the lips, you will find minor salivary glands called the labial glands, which continuously produce saliva that lubricates the inner side of the lips. And keep in mind the structures we went through earlier, they're also associated with the upper lip and the lower lip. Awesome. Now let's talk about the cheeks, or bucca. The shape of the cheek is formed by the buccinator muscle, which is this one. On top of the buccinator muscle, there's a fascia called the buccopharyngeal fascia, which remember covers the buccinator, then goes backwards behind the pharynx. On top of the buccopharyngeal fascia, you will find fat called the buccal fat pad. The buccal fat pad, together with the subcutaneous connective tissue, give the cheeks its definitive appearance. Now, externally to the fat pad, you will find the layers of the skin, and on the inside of the muscle, you will find the mucosal membrane, or tunica mucosa. Now, let's look at the inside of the cheeks a little bit. At the inside of the cheeks, at around this region, you will find the opening of the parotid duct, which is the duct of the parotid gland, as you see here. and around this opening of the parotid duct, you will find the papilla of the parotid duct, which is just going to be a small elevation around where the parotid duct opens into the oral vestibule. And here, just to help you visualize it, imagine for a second that this hole is the opening of the parotid duct, and this is how the papilla of the oral vestibule look like, just some elevations around the opening. So that was everything I had for the anatomy of the cheeks. Now let's cover the inner surface of the oral vestibule and start with the anatomy of the teeth. So let's take this tooth right here and pull it out and then slice the tooth in half in order to see the insides as well. The tooth actually have a very straightforward anatomical structures despite its comprehensive development. It's actually divided into three regions. First, we have the crown of the tooth, which is the visible part of the tooth. Then we have the root of the tooth, which is embedded in the dental alveolus. And between these two parts is a neck, which is the transition between the crown and the root. The neck is covered by the gums, as you see here. Now, the root of the tooth is fixated inside of the dental alveolus, right? And this fixation is supported by something we call the periodontium, which forms the so-called gomphosis, which is a very strong fibrous connection between the root of the tooth and the periosteum on the inner surface of the dental alveolus. The gomphosis is a type of joint we call the dento-alveolar joint, so they are synonyms. Now, within the actual tooth, there's a cavity, and within the cavity, you will find the dental pulp, which is a type of loose connective tissue that is rich in neurovascular structures. The pulp cavity will continue downwards as the root canal, and then at the very bottom of the root, there's an opening called the apical foramen, where the blood vessels and nerves from the mandible and the maxilla enter the tooth. Around the pulp cavity, you will find the dentin, which makes up the basic substance of the tooth. And at the crown region, the dentin is covered by the enamel, which is a very mineralized tissue. And at the region of the neck and the root, you will find the cementum lying just superficially to the dentin, which is a calcified structure around the dentin. And here's a little more detailed view of the layers around the root of the tooth. First, we have the dentin, then the cement around the dentin, and then around the cementum, you will find the periodontal ligament. So that is the general anatomy of the tooth. Now, throughout our lives, we have two sets of teeth. The first set of teeth are called the milk teeth, and there are 20 teeth usually. They begin to show up at around 6 months of life, and then by the time you're 24 months old, approximately, we should have full set of milk teeth. And as we grow, the milk teeth are gradually starting to fall off between the age of 6 to 12 years, and then they start to get replaced by the permanent teeth. The permanent teeth consist of 32 teeth, and the last set of teeth, which appear at around 17 to 24 years, are called the wisdom teeth. They're called the wisdom teeth because they appear late, after all the other teeth have appeared. So, milk teeth and permanent teeth. Now, the arrangement of the teeth are categorized in a specific way. I learned recently that the way they divide the teeth in Europe might differ from the way the teeth are divided in countries like the United States. So keep in mind that this might differ depends on where your sources are from. I study in Europe, so I'll go with that. First, we divide the teeth into four equal quadrants starting from the midline. The first two teeth from the midline are called the incisor teeth, and they get the number 1 and 2. You start counting 1 from the midline, and then 2, and then 3, and so on. So when I say we have 2 incisor teeth, I mean we have 8 incisor teeth, right? Since you count 2 from the midline, from both the maxilla and the mandible. The incisor teeth consist of 1 root, and usually only 1 root canal. So the third tooth is called canine tooth, which also contain 1 root. So we have 4 canine teeth. Then number 4 and 5 are called the premolar teeth. And number 6, 7, and 8 are called the molar teeth, the last one being the wisdom tooth. And so the wisdom tooth is the 8th tooth, which is the molar teeth. And if you count 8 teeth on either quadrant, so 8 times 4 equals 32. That means that we're looking at the permanent teeth now. Since remember, the permanent teeth consists of 32 teeth. The milk teeth differ a little bit, but they are divided in the same way. They have 2 incisor teeth, 1 canine tooth, and 2 molar teeth. So they don't have the premolar teeth as you see here. So that is the main difference between the milk teeth and the permanent teeth. And here you see that the incisors and the canine teeth usually have only one root, but the premolars and molar teeth might have more roots as you see here. So that was the teeth. Now let's talk about the gums, or the gingiva. From the anatomical point of view, the gums is a mucous membrane covering the alveolar process of the maxilla and the mandible, and they form a place for the root to be rooted in, as you see here. Now the gums are mainly composed of dense fibrous tissue, but the actual consistency of the gums differ depending on which region of the gums you're looking at. So for a clinical point of view, the gums is divided into the alveolar mucous membrane and the gum proper. The alveolar mucosa covers the alveolar processes at the level of the root of the tooth, as you see here in blue. This region contains a lot of submucosal connective tissue and is therefore mobile, so it moves if you touch it. The gum proper is the mucosa located at the same level of the neck and the crown of the tooth, as you see here in yellow. The mucosa itself doesn't have a lot of connective tissue here at this region of the gum proper, because it's attached to the periosteum underneath. That's why if you try to move the gums at around the neck of the tooth, you will see that the gums are very hard to move. They barely move at all. And that is because they have less of these loose connective tissue underneath the mucosa. Anatomically, we divide the gums into certain regions. The gingival papillae are the projections you will see between the neck of the teeth. The gingival margin are the elevated margin of the gums around the tooth. And the gingival sulcus are the groove between the margin of the tooth and the teeth. So that was all I had for the anatomy of the oral vestibule. If you found this video helpful, please put a like, share, comment, whatever you find convenient to you. In the next video, we will cover the anatomy of the oral cavity proper.